So Hariom and salutations to one and all. So we are doing the Sant Charitra, and in the life of saints, today we take up the life of the great saint of Bengal, Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa. He lived only for 50 years. 1836 he was born, 1886 he left the body. But the 50 years that he lived has impacted the lives of so many people and generations after generations. A lot of spiritual teachings, principles, you can see manifest in the life of Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa. So he was born in Hooghly district in a small village called Kamarpukur. His parents are Khudiram Chattopadhyay and Chandra Devi. Now, he is born in a very orthodox Brahmin family. His father was a Brahmana, and earlier they used to live, the parents used to live in a different place, not in Kamarpukur. They used to live in Derepur. Derepur is where his father Khudiram Chattopadhyay used to stay earlier. And his father was a devout Brahman. The family deity was Raghuvirji. And his father would worship the deity. And whenever the father would chant the Gayatri Mantra, he would be in ecstasy. The father would be in ecstasy. Tears would roll out from his eyes. So though the family deity, the Kula Devata is Raghuvirji, the father had a lot of bhavana for Gayatri Devi. And being a very orthodox Brahman, he used to follow many strict rules. And at those times, the Varna Vyavastha also was such that, you know, the Shudras and the Brahmanas, there was a lot of gap between them. They were not allowed to, you know, the food is, if they offer, then the Brahmanas, some of them won't eat the food. Of course, that is the degraded version of the Varna Vyavastha, but it was a small village and that was what was being followed there. The mother was a very pious person, but very frank, very open-minded and straight talk. She will tell bluntly what is in her mind. She will not conceal. She was a pious person, but very frank. And it is said that both of them, Khudiram Chattopadhyay and Chandra Devi, they were married in 1799. And to them was born the first son, Ram Kumar, in 1805. Then the daughter, Katyayini, in 1810. Now, in 1814, Khudiram was told by the landlord there in his village, Derepur, to bear a false testimony against somebody in a case. The father refused. He was a righteous person. He said, no, I will not do that. So this landlord, he got very upset and he took away the property of the father, Khudiram Chattopadhyay. And Khudiram Chattopadhyay suddenly was at a loss that there is no property that he has. And only as a Brahmana, you know, he was worshipping the Lord, but the livelihood was coming from the land that was belonging to him, the ancestral property. Now that is gone. So what happened was that he went to Kamarpukur. He knew some other landlord, and that landlord understood his situation, gave him 1 acre of land, and that's how he came to Kamarpukur. Even today, if you go to Kamarpukur, of course, now many more changes have happened there, but one can see it is a very simple like a very rustic village, nothing much developed there, just a few huts are there. It was a very humble living as though. And there he lived with lot of simplicity, contentment. With that 1 acre of land, whatever was getting cultivated, with that he would manage the family. And his time was spent in more of the spiritual disciplines. So this background of his family is important, because how Ramakrishna Paramahamsa came to be born is also because of these pious parents. That is very interesting. The background is very important to know. So here he lived, Khudiram and Chandra Devi, they lived with simplicity, contentment, and doing their sadhana. 10 years after Khudiram came to Kamarpukur, he took up a yatra, padayatra, to Rameshwaram. And worshipping Lord Shiva there. And 2 years after that, they had a son. So that son was named Rameshwar. Again in 1835, when he was 60 years old, he went to Gaya. Now Gaya is the place where the belief is the Vishnu Pada is there. Bhagwan Vishnu had killed a asura called Gayasura by placing his feet on the chest of this Gayasura. So even today Vishnu Pada is there, the temple is there, and a lot of people would visit that place because the Pitru Shraddha happens in Gaya. The final Shraddha of the Pitrus, once you do at Gaya for that particular ancestor, then one doesn't have to do the yearly Shraddha. So when the father went there to Gaya, he had a dream. And in that dream, Lord Vishnu appeared and told him as though that he will be born to him as a son. And it is said at the same time, in the village, in front of a Shiva temple, Chandra Devi was worshipping the Lord. And Lord Shiva also told her that I will be born as your a divine son. Now, both of them exchanged with each other, this is what had happened. And soon enough, a son was born. So 18th February, 1836, the son was born, and he was named Gadadhar, meaning Vishnu Bhagavan. Because the father got the dream there. And actually Shivji told the mother that you will be blessed with a divine son. He didn't say I will be born. He said you will be blessed with a divine son. So the son was named Gadadhar. Now this Gadadhar had two elder brothers, Rameshwar and Ramkumar. Rameshwar and Ramkumar, and Katyayani, the elder sister. And then one more sister was born after him. So there are totally five of them. Now Gadadhar grew up. He was a very healthy child, very dynamic, very enthusiastic, but very pious and noble at heart. And he had tremendous memory power. He used to learn and remember quite a lot, especially the Puranic stories, the kathas of the Lord. Not only he would remember, he would tell it to the people in the village, and everybody would be very delighted to listen to these stories from him. And he would also remember because the father was a Brahmana priest, he would remember many, many shlokas, and he would see the father doing the puja. So he would remember the steps in the puja. And he enjoyed painting, and he also did some sculpting. So he used to make the idols of various gods and goddesses. And one thing he had a lot of aversion to was mathematics. Arithmetics was not his cup of tea. Now, one very interesting thing is at the age of seven, at such a young age, the first mystical experience of Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa happened. He was going in a field. He was having some poha in his hand. He was eating that and he was walking in the field. And there were a lot of dark clouds suddenly which had gathered. Against the backdrop of that black clouds, he saw some cranes flying. That contrast, you know, made his mind completely in a state of wonder, as though he stopped thinking. You know, thought about our mind is filled with a lot of thoughts. The thoughts just stopped and he went into a trance. That was his first experience of samadhi at the age of seven. He fell unconscious, all the poha fell around him. For many hours he was unconscious, people did not know where he is. Finally some relatives came searching and they found him. Now in our scripture, this is called Drishyanuvidha Savikalpa Samadhi. That a sight can produce this experience of samadhi. Then we also have what we call as Shabdanuvidha Savikalpa Samadhi. Just the sound can make that person go into that state of trance. What do they experience in that state? So Ramakrishna Gadadhar at that time. So Gadadhar used to say that experience was indescribable joy and it lasted for a lot of time. He was not aware of anything happening around. You know, so because the boundary of thought is transcended, boundary of ego is transcended for those moments. Now, what we experience in deep sleep, in the, you know, after waking dream, then deep sleep, in that state, there is ignorance, and that state comes naturally. We can't force ourselves to go into that state. Through nature's mechanism, we go from waking to dream to deep sleep. And whatever our karmas are there, they make us come out from deep sleep into dream and back to waking. So there is ignorance in that state, but there is still a lot of experience of bliss. Though our mind is not fully active, that's why we don't experience it in that state while we are there. But when we wake up from that state, we say, I slept like a log. I did not know anything. What happens unconsciously in deep sleep is what will happen consciously in the samadhi. Of course, there must have been some Purva Janma samskar of Ramakrishna Paramahamsa. That's how this has happened. Otherwise, it can't happen just like that. Everything has to have a cause. So even here, so we find in the Gita, Bhagavan says that this person is called as a yoga bhrashta, such a seeker who has been seeking intensely, but for some reason could not realize in that earlier life. Arjuna had asked this question to the Lord that if I am putting efforts, living in self-control, doing spiritual practices, but I don't realize the truth in this life, then what is my condition? Because I didn't enjoy worldly pleasures, nor did I get the state of bliss. And will I have to again start from the beginning? Bhagavan said, no, don't worry. Effort which has been put will never go for a waste. And the person will continue from where one left. And he gives two types of births. He says, either you will be born in the house of a very rich person, Shuchi Naam Srimatam Gehe, Yoga Brashto Bhijayate, where you don't have to worry about the livelihood, etc. And the spiritual practice will continue. Or Athva Yogina Meva Kule Bhavati Dhimatam. Or you will be born in the house of a yogi. This second type of birth is very rare. Etadhi Durlabataram Loke Janma Yadidrisham. Because how many people walk the spiritual path is very few. Even those who walk, not many continue. Those who continue, few people reach that state. So to be born in the house of such a yogi is very rare. Ramakrishna Paramahamsa is born in such a house. His father is very devout person. Mother is very pious person. There is samskar of spirituality right from the childhood. So he had that samskar of his past janmas. Then he is born in such a family. And he also is exposed to this very early in life, the spiritual samskars, the stories, etc. And hence the mind of his, the earlier samskars have got awakened. And at the age of 7, he had the experience of samadhi. How amazing is that? At the same time, in a few days, what happened to him? His father died. When he was 60, he went up, he did a pilgrimage to Gaya. And then Ramakrishna was born. So after, so in 1886, Ramakrishna was born. And then after that, another 7 years. So around the age of 68, 70, he would have passed away. This is the first experience of Sri Ramakrishna about death. First time he's seeing a near and dear one of his passing away. His father passed away. It had a very powerful impact on his mind. Small child, he is still 7 years old. But he understood that life is temporary. And so it is said from then onwards, he started becoming more introvert. And he would go away into a mango orchard and he would sit there. He would be lost in thoughts about death, about life. What is the objective? Why are we here? What should we do with this life? You know, he has already learned a few things about the scriptures, but his questions are there now in his mind. And see what happened. So beautiful. One very powerful thing in Sri Ramakrishna's life is this. We will see this throughout his life. This one principle applies. Whenever he needs a teacher or a guide, in whatever type of sadhana he's pursuing, that type of a teacher comes into his life. He doesn't go searching for any teacher. That's very amazing in his life. That the quest in him is so strong and his mind is so pure that the teacher will come automatically. So like this, when he used to sit in the mango orchard and he used to think and, you know, as a child, how much will he gain that knowledge by himself? He used to read the Puranas. His interest in the stories of the Puranas and the Itihasa, etc., that increased a lot. And he started helping his mother also. He started doing the work at house. He started thinking more about how to make life meaningful. So at such a time, when he was doing whatever he could, thinking, this is the best I can do with this life, he met some of the sadhus and sannyasis. So the village Kamarpukur is on the way to Jagannath Puri. The road, there's a highway that passes through that village. So many sadhus and sannyasis who are going to Jagannath Puri would pass through that village. Ramakrishna started serving them. And he would sit, he would observe. And these are holy people. These are great saints, masters, devotees. And Ramakrishna saw what is the meaning of renunciation. What is it to dedicate oneself to God? How these masters live in self-control? How their mind is absorbed in the divine? How many of them don't have any body consciousness also? And he would do satsang with them. They would teach him. They would tell the stories of the Lord. They would help him to find answers of his questions. And he would in turn serve them. See, many of these are sadhanas which are prescribed to develop bhakti. Prathama bhagati santanakara sangha. The first bhakti is to do the seva of the saints. that he did. Dusari Rati Mama Katha Prasanga. He anyway takes delight in the glories of the Lord. Then Prathama Bhagati Santanakara Sangha, Dusari Rati Mama Katha Prasanga. Guru Pada Pankaja Seva, Tisari Bhagati Aman. Serve the lotus feet of the Guru. 9 steps come in bhakti, Tulsidas ji says in Tulsi Ramaya. Kirtan of the Lord also he was doing. He used to tell the stories of the Lord to the people in the village. So Kirtan, Shravan, Seva, Sadhu Sangati, all this he has got at a very young age. Many times we take any of these for granted. But these are very powerful to develop bhakti in the heart, because bhakti cannot come by reading books alone. It will come only when we do these things. And in that, the first is Sadhu Sangati. Because God is invisible, infinite, absolute truth. Somebody who has experienced in one's heart, who has that purity, or who is a seeker walking that path, that person alone can give bhakti dan to us. A candle which is lit alone can light another candle. How otherwise it is possible? So this Sadhu Sangati he got very early in his life, and he used to serve them. In this way, 2 years passed, and he was now 9 years old, initiated into the Janeyu Samskar. Now, because he is anyway from a Brahmana family and his father was a priest and the family deity is there. So now that the Janeyu Samskar is there, now he gets the Adhikara to study the Veda properly, formally, and also to worship the family deity in a ritualistic way like his father used to do. Now on the day, so if you know that when Janeyu Samskar is done, after the Samskar is over, the Brahmachari asks for bhiksha, bhiksham dehi. That's one part of the Janeyu Samskar vidhi. So the Brahmachari will go for bhiksha. So whoever is present there will give bhiksha. So Ramakrishna went and he sought bhiksha from a Shudra woman. She gave the bhiksha and he ate the food also, which also shows that at a very early age, he did not bother about the social norms and customs, etc. What he valued truly was the sincerity and purity of heart. And that Shudra woman is, you know, she had been a nurse. She has helped him also in childhood. So he had told her that one day I will take food from you. And he fulfilled that promise after he got Janeyu Samskar. That's another beautiful point. He could have taken before. But after he becomes a Brahmana formally, as though after the Janeyu Samskar, he's formally initiated into, he's called as Dvija, twice born. Then he takes. So he's not just innocence, but he's very clear in his thinking that there is no distinction to be done on the basis of birth. What one has to see is the heart. So he says that, you know, piety and religious sincerity are more important than the conventions of society. Now, he started worshipping Raghuvirji. But one very powerful difference is this, that for him, Raghuvirji is not a murti. For him, Raghuvirji is a living embodiment of Bhagavan. That bhav is there in him. See, this bhav comes from Sadhu Sangati. So he developed that bhav because he saw the sadhus, what is the living presence of God in their heart and how they connect to the Lord. So for him, he has caught that bhav. This is something which one has to catch from the saints, not the informative knowledge or the oratorical skills or, you know, the way to impress people or some scriptural quotations. Those one wants, one can take. But Bhavana is what one has to take from the Sant Mahatma. That what is the bhav in their heart for Bhagavan? Can that bhav invoke the bhav of bhakti in our heart? So he used to worship. And because for him, Raghunath ji is embodiment of the Lord himself who is there, everything is real. So he doesn't think that he's feeding a murti. He is thinking he's feeding Bhagavan only. So he doesn't think that, you know, he is offering flowers to the murti. He thinks he's offering flowers to Bhagavan. This bhavana is most important in upasana. Upa means near. Asan means to sit. So upasana means to sit close to the Lord, meaning to have this bhavana that Bhagavan is real and I am worshipping that Supreme Lord. And many times he used to just get absorbed in the thought of the Lord while doing the puja. Now, one more incident happened in his life was that on the Shivratri night, there is supposed to be a play in his village, which is Shivlila. So suddenly the person who was supposed to play the part of Lord Shiva fell ill. So they called him Gadadhar. And he said, you have to play the part of Lord Shiva. So they are dressing him up. You know, they took some ash and they are applying it on his whole body. They put the matted locks on his head. They gave him a trishul. They tied a, you know, tiger skin around his waist. Now, as people are doing this, he thought that Lord Shiva has come into him. And people felt that he is not playing a role. Because when he went on stage, he went forgetting himself. He went forgetting the people around him. He was as though Shiva himself who has come there. Because he went into a bhav samadhi. That is called bhav samadhi in our scriptures. So two types of bhav samadhi are there. One type of bhav samadhi is where that person loses complete awareness of the world outside and is just lost in trance, like how it happened earlier. Second one is seeing, one is not in a withdrawn state. So the body is there, action is happening, but the mind is absorbed in the Lord. And so many things around one is not registering. And hence one says that, you know, he is oblivious of the world outside. So the way he went there on the stage, dialogues, etc. So the what is the leela happening there, that he forgot everything else. But his very presence there and the bhav in which he was, people really felt blessed as though Shiva has given darshan to him. They started crowding there like anything. The organizers had to block people jumping on and running on to the stage. They had to take him away from there. This incident set him thinking. So it is said, he himself said this later on. He said, if just by wearing the costume of Shiva, I can feel this and Shiva comes into me and I can experience such bliss. If actually Shiva gives darshan to me, what will be the joy that I will experience? So what he decided was that he knew many Puranic stories and he used to tell people also. Now what he decided with his group of friends, they found one, you know, mango grove, and they used to enact various leelas there. So from Ramayana, from Mahabharata, they used to enact various parts. And when they enact these various parts, of these, the most famous part, the most favorite, not famous, the most favorite part of Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, you know, what he liked very much was the Leela between Shri Krishna and the gopis. So it is said that the Vrindavan episode of Shri Krishna's life depicting the bhav of the gopis, that Leela was most dear to him. And sometimes he would play the role of Radhaji, sometimes he would play the role of Shri Krishna, and he would lose himself into that character when he is playing these roles. Now see the various ways in which these spiritual sadhanas have happened in his life. What we may look down, or we may think about it as just entertainment or just some acting or just some frivolous drama, for him it is a spiritual sadhana to live the bhavana of a gopi or of Radhaji or of Shri Krishna. Well, he becomes that character fully. So that becomes a very important means to sublimate the ego. So he used to do that. And it is said that he used to pray in his heart that when will I be also born as a Radha so that I can be one with Krishna. He would feel that I must be born in a woman's body so that I can become a Radha and I can love Shri Krishna in the way she loved Shri Krishna. This would be his bhav. Now it is said 1849, Ram Kumar, the eldest brother, went to Kolkata. Because there are five of them, father has also passed away, and better job prospects, etc. So he went searching for a job to improve the financial conditions of the family. So Ramakrishna is by that time 13 years old. He is very young. And people loved him there. Many elderly women, they used to think of him as Gopala. He's the baby Krishna. They would consider him as Gopala. And the younger ones, they saw him as the young Krishna of Vrindavan. So Ramkumar went, and in 3 years' time, Ramkumar called him to Kolkata, thinking that, let him assist me in the priest duties, etc. So he called him to Kolkata, and he had opened a Sanskrit academy so that apart from the priest job, he can have a side income also. And he wanted Ramakrishna Gadadhara to study there, get familiar with the literature, become a teacher. So he was thinking in that direction. Meanwhile, because Gadadhar was a Brahmana, formally initiated, and he knew the puja paddhati. So he used to take him along with him to do the pujas. In various houses, they used to go and perform pujas. And people there would be very touched by the bhav with which Ramakrishna or Gadadhar used to do the puja. So he would reach many hours early. He would decorate the whole altar beautifully with lot of patience, devotion, and he would conduct that entire puja with lot of bhavna, with purity of mind. And so many people were very impressed with this, the natural purity in his heart. He was not trying to impress anybody. Natural bhav and purity. And as a result of this, he didn't pay much attention to his studies. The brother wanted him to study, get educated properly, get a nice job or teach properly somewhere. But his mind was not into that. So one day he decided to warn. So Ramkumar called Gadadhar and said that you have to be a householder, you have to earn the livelihood, and you have to do your duties. You must get the proper knowledge as a Brahmana. You must learn the Shastra. You must learn astrology. You must learn the Hindu laws. You must learn various other subjects. And it is said that what Ramakrishna Gadadhar explained to him, he said, brother, what shall I do with a mere bread winning education? I would rather acquire that wisdom which will illumine my heart and give me satisfaction forever. Because he saw, see, he's been in Kolkata now for a few months and years now, and he saw very clearly that is the time when the British education, etc., had replaced our education system. So he saw, you know, that the greed and lust held sway in the higher levels of society. And many religious practices were happening, but the soul is lacking in that. And people took pride in shunning their culture. People took pride in being atheists and agnostics. People looked down upon their own culture. Sanskrit education was removed. Scholarships were given to study English. And the English ways, the Western ways, people used to think that if we follow those, we are most elite. So many of these things he saw. But for him, what was most important was, he says, the legacy of Ram, Krishna, Buddha, Shankara, Ramanuja, Chaitanya. This was the security, not the worldly possessions and achievements. And he used to think of many of these wise people as vultures. In his own words, he would give later example as they are vultures. They are soaring high in the sky, but their eyes are on the flesh. So they are learned pundits and learned scholars, and they can give big arguments, but no devotion in the heart. Their mind is stuck with gold, with sense enjoyments. Now see, he has lived a life in the village for 13 years, and the whole samskara is very different in his mind. He has interacted with sadhu, sannyasis, the world which they have shown him, and what he has seen in their life manifesting had changed his vision completely. When he came into the city, see, many people come from village into the city, but the city life completely can overwhelm many people. Ramakrishna never got overwhelmed with the city life. His vivek was very sharp, and his vairagya also was very sharp. Bhakti also was very clear. So bhakti, vivek, vairagya so strong in him, he did not allow this city life to change his thinking. So we may call him, he is not very educated, illiterate from the formal, standpoint. But he had real education. That education which liberates, that is called education. Sa vidya ya vimuktaye. That is knowledge which liberates. He had that knowledge. And so, the impact of the city life did not change his thinking. Because many people, you know, they were very impressed. And so many people even were converting. Because these Christian missionaries also were there. And many of them were converting. So he said, you know, that the Christian missionaries gave the finishing touch. They ridiculed as relics of a barbarous age the images and rituals of the Hindu religion. They tried to persuade India that the teachings of her saints and seers were the cause of her downfall, that her Vedas, Puranas, and scriptures were filled with superstition. So many intelligent young Hindus became converted. And they convinced these young people that Christianity had given the white races position and power in the world and assurances of happiness in the next. Therefore, Christianity was the best of all religions. Now he is seeing all this happening. So he also saw that many elite educated people were doing all this. At the same time, very humble, simple folk of the country also were getting converted because they don't know. They are thinking these people are more greater than us. And he also saw in between a certain type of people who were confused, who didn't know what should we do. This is the social circumstance of that time. That also we should not forget. So the youth of India taught in English schools took malicious delight in openly breaking the customs and traditions of their society. And they would consider, so it is said here that everyone living near Calcutta or the other strongholds of Western culture, even those who attempted to cling to the orthodox traditions of Hindu society, became infected by the new uncertainties and the new beliefs. And amidst this backdrop is where Ramakrishna Gadadhar is telling his brother that what shall I do with a mere bread-winning education? Because he's seeing all this happening. That people have left their roots completely. They have no idea of what their culture is. In fact, they are now becoming criticizers of this culture. So, finally, his brother had to let him go. He couldn't insist more because Ramakrishna refused to study and, you know, get the breadwinning education. At that time, there was this a rich widow called Rani Rasmani. Now, it is very interesting. This Rani Rasmani belongs to the Shudra community. But she is known far and wide, not only for her business ability, courage, and intelligence, but also for her large-hearted piety and for her devotion to God. And her son-in-law, Mathur Mohan, was assisting her in managing all the work that she had. So in 1847, the Rani purchased 20 acres of land at Dakshineshwar. And there she created a temple garden and constructed several temples. Her Ishta Devata was Mother Kali. So even if you go there to Dakshineshwar today, you will see that Mother Kali temple is there, beautiful temple. And the goddess there is very powerful. Then there are, so the suppose Kali temple is here. In front, there are 12 Shiva temples. And then there is one Radhakant Mandir also. That is Lord Krishna and Radhaji. So this brother Ram Kumar brought Ramakrishna there. And there we find that an incident happened where the idol of Radha, of Krishna Bhagwan, was accidentally dropped. And it was a little damaged. So the regular priest there said, we can't worship a damaged murti, we have to get a new murti. But this Rani Rasmani, she loved that idol very much. So she asked Ramakrishna's opinion, that what do you say? Ramakrishna said, if your nephew broke his arm, what will you do? Will you discard your nephew? You will take care. You will, you know, nurse him back to health. So repair the murti and worship. It was not as per the tradition of the Veda, etc. But this was born from the purity of his heart. And Rani Rasmani loved this answer because born from his bhavana. Because for him, it is not a murti. For him, it is Bhagwan. And you have been worshipping Bhagwan. So how can you just discard that murti? That is his bhavana. So Rani Rasmani not only accepted his advice, she sacked that priest and Ramakrishna, she requested that, will you please worship? And Ramakrishna accepted. So Ramakrishna started worshipping the murti of Radha Krishna first, before he enters into the Kali temple. That we will see how he enters there. He started living there as a priest who worshipped Radha Krishna. Now, more of this I will continue in the next satsang. Today I have to go a little early. 7 o'clock, there is another satsang. So we will continue. Wish you all a very happy Deepavali and a great new year. May the Lord's grace and blessings light the hearts of all of us with the lamps of devotion, with the lamp of knowledge, and the lamp of selflessness. Hari Om.
Hari Om.
Hari Om, Swamiji.
Hari Om.
Hari Om.